Reading Comprehension 74 iQuanta Video Analysis. The modern multinational corporation is described as having originated when the owner managers of the 19th century British firms carrying on international trade were replaced by the teams of salaried managers organized into hierarchies. So earlier the owner used to be the manager prior to the 19th century, which means the 1800s for the British firms. But then thereafter, owners basically kept in managers who were professionals and were salaried and did not have any ownership in the company and were organized into hierarchies. So you'll have a general manager and then, you know, a manager for every trade unit and so on and so forth. So that is when he says the modern multinational corporations came into being. Increases in the volume of transactions in such firms are commonly believed to have necessitated this structural change. So why did it happen? Because the volume of transactions increased. Owner managers were not capable of looking after so many transactions and such bulk of transactions. So then there was also a need of professional management as well as a need for more managers than the owners could themselves manage. So what was the next step? They started hiring managers who were salaried and qualified but did not have any ownership, and that is how your multinational corporations came into being. So the primary reason is thought to be the volume of transactions increasing. Now it says, why did the volume of transactions increase? Well, in the 19th century, inventions like the steamship and the telegraph, by facilitating the coordination of managerial activities, are described as the key factors. So they facilitated the coordination of managerial activities, thus made the businesses more efficient and thus increased the volume of transactions that could happen, and thereby required management structure to change, which is why MNCs came into being. The 16th and the 17th century, the ones prior, chartered trading companies, despite the international scope of their activities, are usually considered irrelevant to this discussion. The volume of their and why are they considered irrelevant to the discussion of MNCs? Because the volume of their transaction is assumed to be too low, and the communication and the transportation that existed at that day too primitive. So thus they say that the charter trading companies belong to a completely different class. When we start discussing MNCs, we say that they first came into being into the 19th century, and that is correct. And they are something new which started happening and not connected to chartered trading companies. So there is no direct evolution from chartered trading companies to modern multinational corporation. This is an entirely new structure and new way of working. However, so which means the author is going to contradict with this. However, early trading companies successfully purchased and outfitted ships. They also built and operated offices and warehouses. They manufactured trade goods for use abroad. They maintained trading posts and production facilities overseas. They also procured goods for import. And lastly, and they sold the goods both domestically and internationally. So they had fairly complex and multiple functionalities that they were doing, the early trading companies. Now, the author says, the large volume of transactions, of course, if you're doing so many things, you will be changing a lot of money. So the large volume of transactions associated with these activities seems to have necessitated a hierarchical management structure well before the advent of modern communication and transportation. So he's saying that look, they were doing so many things, even they had large volumes of transaction, which is why even they needed hierarchical management. For example, now he's giving the first example. He says the Hudson Bay Company, which each far-flung trading outpost was managed by a salaried agent. So there were salaried managers who carried out the trade with Native Americans, managed day-to-day operations, and oversaw post workers and servants. One chief agent, so there is a hierarchy, there is a chief agent, and then there are multiple post agents. Answerable, and our chief agent is then further answerable to court of directors. So he's directed with court of directors in London, so in head office. through correspondence committee. So there is a correspondence committee in between CC, and then there is a court of directors. through corresponding committee was appointed with the control over all the agents at the bay. So there is hierarchy, there is salaried management, these are all salaried managers. The early trading companies did differ strikingly from modern multinationals in many respects though. What are those respects? First, they depended heavily on the national governments of their home countries. You know, East India Company dependent largely on the British Empire with all the army and whatever they required, and thus characteristically acted abroad to promote national interests. So they had to promote national interests, which you do modern MNCs don't do, right? Vodafone has no interest of the British government that it is representing here. So that ways they're different. Their top managers typically were owners. So the chief agent would mostly be some son, daughter of an owner with substantial minority share. Today, even GM level, even CEOs are not owners. They have a very minute minority share in most of the multinational corporations. Whereas senior managers holding in modern multinationals are usually insignificant. They operated in pre-industrial world, grafting a system of capitalist international trade onto a pre-modern system of artisan and peasant production. So the older ones were capitalist international trade, basically trade used to make profits on the hands of a pre-modern system of artisans and peasant production. So those MNCs, those early trading companies were not producing anything. They were just basically selling, artisans work, peasants, farm products and arts and goods, but did not produce anything and were just basically facilitating trade and making money out of it. Despite these differences, now the author is saying, despite these differences, however, early trading communities organized effectively in remarkable modern ways. And he says, merit further study as analogs of modern structures. So when you are studying MNCs, you also need to study early trading companies, or charter trading companies, to be able to match and compare and see what all differences actually came about and how transition happened between from charter trading companies to MNCs. Okay, now let's come on to the questions. So the first question says, author's main point is that modern multinationals originated in the 16th and 17th centuries with establishment of chartered trading companies. But it is believed that the modern multinationals came up in the 19th century, and 16th and 17th century was era of chartered companies. Right? But that is not the so modern multinationals came in the 19th century, not in the 16th and the 17th century. So this is incorrect. B says, the success of early charter trading companies like that of modern multinationals depended primarily on their ability to carry out complex operations. That is outside the scope of the passage, though he has listed the operations carried out by, early chartered trading companies, but it is nothing to do with their success or failure. So that is incorrect. C says, early chartered trading companies would be more seriously considered by scholars studying the origins of modern multinationals. Yes, that is correct. As we know, early charter companies did have enough volumes of trade to necessitate hierarchical management structures. They ran dispersed operations, which calls for further study of them as analogs to modern multinationals. So this is the correct option and your OA. The last one says, the scholars are quite mistaken concerning the origins of modern multinationals. No, origins of modern multinationals is timed correctly, but the reason to why it happened is partially incorrect. So they are not also mistaken about the origins. They have gotten the time correct, and they have partially also gotten the reason correct, the large volumes. All they have gotten incorrect is that large volumes also existed for early charter trading companies, ECTC, early charter trading companies. So That is why it is incorrect. So they got these two things right. What they, however, did not get right was that the previous ones had nothing to do with it and they are not. So this is all they got correct. The only thing that they could not get correct was the ECTC part. So saying that they were quite mistaken is incorrect, and that is why we are cancelling this option. Question number 2, according to the passage, ECTC are usually described as irrelevant to a discussion of origins of modern multinational corporation. Yes, the author says that in the 16th and 17th century, the trading companies, despite of their international scope of activities, were considered irrelevant while doing the study of modern multinational corporations. However, we know that the volume of transactions and means of connecting were too primitive to make those comparisons. So they were considered irrelevant at that point of time. However, later the author has contradicted that. But according to the passage, ECTC are usually described as irrelevant to a discussion regarding the origins of MNC, because they are considered very primitive in ways of connecting, in terms of physically connecting and exchanging goods, communication, as well as the trade volumes were thought, their volume of transactions was thought to be less. However, the author has later disproved all of that, but that is what they are usually described as. So this is your OA, but we will also read through other options. Interesting, but ultimately too unusually to be good subjects for economic study. It is irrelevant. Nothing has been mentioned about them not being interesting. C and D are exact opposite of what the passage says. C says analogs to the 19th century British trading firms. That is what the author is saying, that they should be considered as, but they are not. So that is incorrect. Rudimentary and very early forms of modern multinational corporations. Yes, they are predecessors, but that is not what they are considered. They are considered completely as a different class as of now. So that makes A the OA. Next one, it can be inferred from the passage that the author would characterize the activities engaged in by early chartered trading companies as being. So what does he think of that? So first one, complex enough in scope to require substantial amount of planning, coordination on the part of management. Exactly, the passage says that is correct. The passage says the early trading companies maintained ships, built and operated offices and warehouse, manufactured goods that are traded, ran trading posts and offices, transacted supplies as well as goods both domestically and internationally, and maintained a large volume of transactions. All of this was complex and necessitated hierarchical management and, of course, planning and coordination, because this hierarchical management involved post agents, which would then report to chief agents, who would communicate it back home through communication committee, if I'm not wrong, correspondence committee to the court of directors sitting in London, who would take decisions. So that, of course, you can infer as some amount of planning and coordination, definitely, because these people will have to coordinate with each other to take actions, and planning also, because it was going to some court of directors in London to, for planning purposes. So that becomes your OA. Other three, too simple to be considered like those of modern national corporation. Of course, they were complex and not simple, so that is incorrect. As intricate as those carried by the largest multinational corporation. So this is the exact opposite, C is exact opposite of B, but still incorrect, because he is saying that they are analogous to modern multinational corporations in the way that you can draw some parallels, but you can't say that they are at par in terms of complexity. So that is also incorrect. D, often unprofitable due to slow communication, is out of scope of the passage. We don't know if they were profitable or unprofitable. There has been no mention of that. The last question says the author lists the various activities of early chartered companies in order to. Why is he, listing them out? The option A says analyze the various ways in which these activities contributed to the changes in management structure in such companies. Well, there has been no analysis as such of their impact on the management structure. The passage has said that it required or necessitated an hierarchical management structure, and it also details what the management structure was, but it doesn't say that, you know, because of this outpost being there, because of this kind of activity being there, this kind of management layer was added. None of that has been explained or in the passage. So the word analyze is incorrect. Had it been explain, actually it has nothing to do. The management structure has been explained for a completely different reason, and no contribution has been directed from activities to this. So this option is incorrect, and I don't think changing just the word analyze would have actually even made a difference. So this option is completely incorrect. B says, demonstrate the volume of business transactions of such companies exceeded that of earlier firms. Now, there is no mention of any firm preceding the early chartered trading firm in this passage as of now. So B is also incorrect. C says, refute the view that volume of business undertaken by such companies was relatively low. Yes, the author categorically says that, you know, with all these operations and activities, the volume of transactions was high. So he refutes that explanation that was given previously and is the general belief. Last one says, emphasize the international scope of these companies' operations. That is not the primary aim. In fact, if you look at it, he says that the early trading companies shipped even to the domestic markets, or, you know, supplied even to the domestic markets. Where does he say that? He says that, right? He says that here, that, you know, these sold goods both at home and in other countries. So, and home. So there were domestic operations as well. So if he was just focusing on, you know, the international operations, then he would have not mentioned home. So that is also incorrect. So C is your OA. I hope you have understood this passage and there is no confusion around it. However, if you still have questions, you can put them in the comment section below.